Welcome to the Bakersfield City Council meeting. This television broadcast is brought to you by the local cable companies, the County of Kern, and the City of Bakersfield. You can watch the rebroadcast of this meeting Saturday at 7 p.m., Sunday at 10 a.m., and the following Wednesday at 7 p.m. You can download the agenda for this meeting at www.bakersfieldcity.us. Presiding over this evening's meeting, the Honorable Karen Goh.
Good evening. It's my pleasure to call to order the 5:15 City Council meeting of February 15th, 2017. Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Mayor Goh.
Here.
Vice Mayor Smith.
I'm here.
Councilmember Rivera.
Here.
Councilmember Gonzalez.
Here.
Councilmember Weir.
Here.
Councilmember Sullivan. Councilmember Parlier.
Here and here.
Thank you.
Here. For the record.
Thank you. Welcome, everyone. At this time, we would ask you to stand for the invocation, which is going to be offered by Pastor Tony Kim from Renaissance of Bakersfield. And then please remain standing for the Pledge of Allegiance by Emily Frank, 10th grade student, very active driller at Bakersfield High School. So we'll just start, Pastor Kim.
Your face to shine upon us, that your way may be known on the earth, your salvation among the nations. Father, we pray right now that you would bless our time together, Lord, that as we seek your face and call upon you, that you would release your wisdom, your guidance, understanding.
Lord, that you would give all of our leaders here wisdom. Father, that you would lead them, that you would give them your heart, that you would give them an understanding of your heart for the city. God, that they would restore joy, healing, and advancement, God, for all that you have for this beautiful city. So, Lord, we call upon your name. We ask that your kingdom come and your will be done in our city for your glory, that this city would be a model city for the nation and for the rest of the cities in America to give hope. Father, so I pray that hope would be instilled and hope would be released as we meet today. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.
Salute, pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
You may be seated. Thank you so much, Pastor Kim and Emily Frank and family, proud family, following her out the door. They're all super involved together in our community. Here are a few guidelines just to help our meeting run smoothly. We request that you turn off your phones. Council members aren't allowed to send or receive electronic communications during the meeting, and we would ask you to be courteous in the use of your cameras and videos. Applause is allowed during presentations only, but it isn't allowed during the other portions of the meeting. And for safety reasons, and as a courtesy to others, no signs are allowed in the council chambers. And we just thank you for your cooperation and helping us to have a very smooth meeting. Madam Clerk, would you please read the first item?
We have a presentation of a proclamation to Christy Oropesia, Heidi Carter Escudero, and Bakersfield Fire Department Chief Doug Grinner, declaring February 2017 Safety Surrender Baby Awareness Month.
I am so thankful for all of you, and I'm thankful that out of something that could be so tragic, you're bringing great joy to families. And so I would like to read something, and then we'll give you some time for comments. Proclamation, Office of the Mayor. The Mayor of the City of Bakersfield, California has officially proclaimed February 2017 as Safely Surrendered Baby Awareness Month in the city in recognition of the efforts of the Safely Surrendered Baby Coalition to save and welcome babies from abandonment in dangerous places, in recognition of the partnership of government, nonprofit organizations, private business, and individual citizens committed to providing places of sanctuary for these babies, in recognition of the need to heighten public awareness regarding this issue and the need to provide a safe haven for the innocent newborns involved, and in recognition of the 57 precious infants safely surrendered since the program began in Kern County in 2006. And it's signed Karen Goh, Mayor of the City of Bakersfield. Thank you so much again for being here. And Chief Greener, we're going to take a picture together if our photographer is ready. And then comments. Oh, we have one up there. Would you like to come up this way? Oh, she's going to be shy. Come up closer. Thank you very much. Go ahead.
Thank you, Mayor Goh, and the entire City Council for this proclamation and for your continued support of this important initiative. I am Christy Rapeza, current chair of the Safe Surrender Baby Coalition. Pleased to share with you and the community the life-saving work of the Safely Surrender Coalition. As you can see by these folks standing with me, the Department of Human Services is not alone. We lead this ongoing effort of educating our community about the Safely Surrendered Baby Law. Joining me tonight to receive this proclamation are two of our many partners, Bakersfield Chief Doug Greener and First Five Executive Director Roland Meyer, as well as committee member Heidi Escudera. Since 2006, when the Department of Human Services began tracking safely surrendered babies, 57 newborns have been surrendered in Kern County. Last year alone, two babies were saved through this program in our community. Safe Surrender Baby Law allows for women in crisis the option of walking into a fire station and hospital emergency room to surrender the baby into the arms of a fireman, nurse, or any hospital personnel. They do so without providing their name or any personal information, with no fear of being prosecuted for child abandonment. That is the simple mission of the Safely Surrendered Baby Coalition, to get this message out, to prevent tragic abandonment of newborns. The coalition in Kern has grown to include many of our hospitals, including Dignity Health, San Joaquin, Kern Medical, and outlining regional hospitals. First Five, who once again provided funding this year to help us in our outreach efforts. Through the support of First Five, a public service announcement will be airing in Kern County movie theaters. Also, in your packets that we've provided is a very long list of events where we will continue our outreach efforts within the community, including proclamations from other city councils, including Delano, Taft, McFarland, Arvin, and Shafter. We'd like to thank you again for this proclamation and allowing us this time. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you to the Safely Surrendered team. And I had the privilege yesterday, I was just talking with a friend, and she mentioned that a friend of hers is the mother of a safely surrendered baby. So you never know when it's going to hit your friends. So get the word out. Thank you again, team. Madam Clerk, next item, please.
Mayor, we have 17 speaker cards this evening. We have three on one subject. We have four on various other subjects, and we have 10 on the same subject. However, half are in favor and half are against. So those 10 I will call last, and we'll get the individual ones done first.
Thank you. Let me just go over some guidelines. We're going to receive public statements now. All statements are given a 3-minute time limit. Would you just do this together? Three minutes, and that applies to each of us. 15 minutes per topic, and so that's total So if you have a lot of speakers on there, it's still 15 minutes per topic. And we're going to ask all of the speakers right now, as I finish reading the guidelines, to come forward so that we can save time. So come up to the front rows. If you have written comments that are longer than your verbal statement, give them to the clerk, and she'll give copies to the council. We would ask you to avoid any behavior that disrupts the meeting. We're super, very, very interested and concerned with your issues, but due to the public notice requirement of the Brown Act, the council can't take action when an item isn't on the agenda. The council can, however, refer your matter to committee or request that staff contact you. So the clock will be up here for those of you who haven't been here before, and you can just see your 3 minutes when the 3 minutes would be up. So Madam Clerk, please call the first public speaker.
Savannah Lee, World Mission Society.
Good evening. Welcome, and please introduce yourself.
Good evening. My name is Savannah Lee, and I'm speaking on behalf of the World Mission Society Church of God in Bakersfield. First, we'd like to thank everyone for allowing us to come here tonight to speak with you. I would like to introduce to you our church. The Church of God is a non-denominational, international Christian church, and we have established over 2,500 churches in 175 countries of the world. We believe in the existence of God the Father and God the Mother, and as testified in the Bible. And our church was established in 1964 in South Korea by the Second Coming Christ, Christ Ahn Sang-hong, and is currently being led by our Heavenly Mother, also in South Korea. Our church was established in the United States in 1997, and then we came to Bakersfield, California in 2011. So let me explain a little bit of how we came to Bakersfield. Some members from our church in Los Angeles came to Bakersfield for a mission trip to preach the prophecies of the Bible. And in 2011, a newly baptized family offered their home as a place for us to keep worship services. And then in 2013, after 3 years, we moved into an office building in downtown Bakersfield. And then in 2016, we finally moved into our first church building in South Bakersfield. So after just 6 years, we have 300 registered members just in the Bakersfield branch alone, and 2.5 million in the world. Now, I'd briefly like to share with you some of the accomplishments. Since 2011, we've received 5 Gold Call to Service Awards and 1 Lifetime Achievement Award signed by the 44th President Barack Obama. In 2016, we were honored with the Queen's Award for Voluntary Service, and were invited to a banquet at the Buckingham Palace in celebration. And then in December this last year, we were invited to the United Nations conference in the headquarters in New York. So now you may be interested on what we have to offer for Bakersfield. In 2015, we actually began working with John Enriquez from Keep Bakersfield Beautiful, and we started to hold cleanup campaigns in Old Town Kern. So the mission of Keep Bakersfield Beautiful is to engage individuals to take greater responsibility for improving their community, and this is what we fully intend to do. On the 26th of this month, which is February 26th, in about a week and a half, we'll be holding our 3rd cleanup campaign on Baker Street, and we would like to invite the Honorable Mayor Goh, as well as Ward 2 council member Andre Gonzalez, and of course the rest of the council members as well. This will be the 3,560th cleanup campaign that we've done internationally. Also, in coming up in March, we'll be holding a blood drive as well. So with everything we at the Church of God, we really take pride in being involved with our community. And even though it's very recently that we've become involved, we're really excited to build a strong relationship with the community as well as the members in Bakersfield. So again, we'd like to thank you for allowing us to come and introduce our church to you. And we hope that we can do many things for the community to keep Bakersfield beautiful as well. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ms. Lee. Madam Clerk, next speaker, please.
Cindy Parra, regarding a GET Transit update.
Good evening. Welcome, and please introduce yourself.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. My name is Cindy Parra. I am the appointee of the council members to the Golden Empire Transit Board, and I just have a brief update to the council. We've tried to do this twice a year, maybe 3 times a year. We had one vacancy for a couple months, so we kind of skipped the end of last year, so I'm here now to give you that update. Next week, the board will be holding our strategic workshop on February 21st. That's to line out our strategic plan and our vision for the future of GET. GET was also nominated for a KernCog Award of Merit for regional cooperation with the city and the county, which was a successful partnership that we had between GET and the city, where we gave $500,000 to the city to improve some of the transit stops to be more accessible to pedestrians, wheelchairs, walking, biking, all that. It included some curb and gutter, some sidewalks, some paving, and I think even some handicap ramps. And we are now in the process of our second round, I think, of funds that we have given the city to continue those improvements at those stops. We've also been involved in legislative meetings locally and in DC with our board chair, Jim Hunter, and with our CEO to advocate against removing transit from the Highway Trust Fund and elimination of the FTA, which is rumored to be a part of this incoming administration's agenda. We've also had a little bit of setback in our acquiring property for our relocation, because the high-speed rail has pushed back their EIR until April. So we're really kind of at a standstill there as far as trying to acquire some property so that we can move our facility. As you know, our facility, our existing facility, is right in the middle of the F Street alignment. So it's very important that we get this EIR done and get our property so we can move. GET also conducts quarterly food distributions at our downtown transit center. We just had one January 20th where we gave away 380 bags of food. We also had some services out there, such as mental health services and other resources for our riders that use the buses. We've started collective bargaining with the Teamsters Local 518. We are in the process of those labor negotiations, and we have meetings scheduled. Finally, we have this was in our local paper. It was a study done by Dr. Grammy that the bottom line was that for every $1 invested in transit, you could get $5.80 return on that. So if you'd like that email to you, we can do that. So thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Parra.
All right.
Madam Clerk, next item, please. Next public speaker.
Xavier Hines regarding body cameras.
Welcome. Please introduce yourself.
I'm Xavier, and this is my friend Timothy. We were here last month talking about pretty much the same thing. The police brutality case, for those of you guys who don't know, that happened on December 5th that night. We were just coming to say the body cameras things for the cops, that should be introduced for them, because I feel if they had body cameras, that wouldn't have happened that night. It would have been avoided.
Not only that, the protocol in which they come at young African-Americans should be switched, and they should try to work on new things just to bring the community and the police department together, and we can be more as one and against instead of against each other. So, you know, it's just some things to think about. And that's pretty much it.
Yeah, that's it.
Thank you, Mr. Hines. Mr. Crismore, thank you. Next public speaker, Madam Clerk.
Oh, I'm sorry.
We have one more speaker on that subject, Mayor.
Okay, and then we also have some comments right now. So, okay. Councilmember Sullivan.
Take the speaker and then look.
Okay,
the
we'll take that speaker.
Okay. Patrick Johnson, same subject.
Good evening, Council, Mayor Goh. Thank you for your time, your efforts of being here today Thank you for allowing me to speak on this particular subject of police brutality that have happened across the board to many individuals in this city, and the way that we want to improve any type of violence that is happening. I've asked the council to put this as an agenda item at the last meeting, as the body cameras and a community police site overview liaison committee that has been presented in other cities as well. We would petition that you put this in your practices, as we've been aware of cases that have happened since Timothy and Xavier, but those individuals are scared to come forth. One of them is also a person that could have been my grandmother. And so this is dire for us to move on this action. Some of the things that we'll be moving forward, especially going into February and March, and working with the police department on efforts on how we can improve in that effort, but believe that we're asking the city council to put this as a agenda item so that you can start to talk and dialogue and take some action on the police body cameras and the police overview committee. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Jackson. Councilmember Sullivan? Sorry, that just slid down. Councilmember Parlier.
Thank you, Mayor. Sir, just like you know, the issue of body cameras was referred to the Budget and Finance Committee, and at some point they'll be discussing that topic.
And then Councilmember Rivera.
Well, he took the words out of my mouth, so I don't have much else to say other than I sit on Budget and Finance and am very interested in that conversation. And I'll say separately that depending on how that conversation goes, this may be an item that then also becomes appropriate to go to Safe Neighborhoods, which I also chair, if I'm not entirely satisfied with how things go at Budget and Finance. Thank you.
Madam Clerk, next public speaker.
Mr. Douglas Howard on a code enforcement public notice issue.
Good
welcome.
Evening. Mark, welcome. Thank you. I was here a little over a month ago, and I made a statement about code enforcement. I just want to state, when you get a letter from code enforcement, it has three different items on it. It has your violations, it has to give you a choice of what you can do, and if you don't do it, the consequences. When they send you that letter, they also send you the violations and the code that's on the computer, and I want to thank whoever's written it, because it's so simple even a child can see. In that statement, it says that it is unlawful for any person, firm, or corporation to place, erect, maintain, or permit a placing of any structure on the property. When it came time for me to report this issue, I reported to code enforcement at least four times, where at this point they're on a first name basis. And I feel like it's being ignored, so I have to put the city on public notice that this situation is there, and that the wall is on city property. Now, it's so serious that they require $1 million liability insurance on this violation. And if it's that much of an issue for that amount of insurance, it tells me that there's a chance that it could happen. And I don't want to be the first person in my neighborhood for this to happen to. So what I'm doing is, this is on the city property, and I've been waiting for someone from the city to contact me in reference to it, but I have had no contact with the city or Mr. Rivera. And so I'm back here again because it's an issue of my safety and my wife's safety. And with code enforcement, their mission statement is considered as safety and health of people in the neighborhood. Now, this is a safety issue by this wall being here. And I cannot go out and make corrections to my driveway without getting a permit. And why should I get a permit when the person next to me don't have a permit that created this problem? The law is the law, and the code is the code. If a person is driving down the street and 10 people are driving at 60 miles an hour. Only the person that gets to stop is one person. He can't say that the rest of you didn't get a ticket. The law gives that person that violated the law the ticket. And at this situation, this person that's next to me that created a problem is violating the code enforcement. And I'm just asking that something be done about it, because I cannot correct my problem without violating the code in order to do this. So I'm issuing this formally with a list of the violations, so maybe someone from the city can look at it and I don't have to go to the city attorney in order to forward the issue. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Howard. You can give that to the city clerk. That's fine. Thank you. Next public speaker, Madam Clerk.
Mayor, the next 4 to 5 speakers are regarding the PACE loan, and they are against the subject. And the first one would be Mr. Relic, are you for or against?
Four.
Okay.
Madam Mayor.
Then this would be, the first speaker against would be Sarah Silvestro.
Thank you.
Welcome. Go ahead.
Okay. Thank you. My name is Sarah, and I purchased, my husband and I purchased our home in April. And we had come to find out in December that we had an $8,000 debt in our taxes. We found this out from the mortgage company, who sent us a letter saying that we would owe $1,800 a month until this was paid off. Now, mind you, this is almost twice our current mortgage, and it was an extreme burden, and it took us about 4 months through our escrow company to resolve this. It ended up that there was a $42,000 loan taken out for an air conditioning system through the PACE/HERO program, and we, as the purchaser, were responsible for that debt, of which we had no knowledge of. There was no report when we purchased the home saying this. The seller had not disclosed that there was a loan. It took, at that 4 months, which would make it June, the escrow company had paid us about half of what we had paid out, and then had to sue the seller for this debt. It took another 4 months for us to continue paying. This was a slightly reduced amount, but it was $1,300 a month, which comes out to $5,200 for the next 4 months, because it would not be eliminated via tax roll until they reviewed everything. So basically, again, we were responsible for paying an extreme debt that we had not been aware of. So all in all, it took 10 months and about $12,000 for us to keep our homes, and you know, there was no disclosure and no awareness. So I am extremely upset about this, obviously, and I don't want it happening to other people. It was very manipulative, and it was, you know, it was an extreme burden, and I could see a lot of people not being able to continue keeping their homes if this continues. So I'm just asking that you really consider this and try to at least put some kind of disclosure minimum on it, because it's not, you know, it really has hurt the people purchasing homes who are stuck with this burden. So I appreciate your time. Thank you. And I really urge you to help us to find a better solution than what's being presented here. So thank you very
much. Thank you, Ms. Salvistro. Madam Clerk?
Yes. Sherry Anthes, same issue.
Before our next speaker, Council Member Gonzalez has a comment.
Thank you, Mayor Goh. I am referring this item to Budget and Finance Committee, the committee I chair. And I recognize that there are several folks who would like to speak to this issue tonight. I invite you to join us at the Budget and Finance Committee to speak there. By all means, you're welcome to speak at public comments tonight at the council meeting. However, since we are referring this to Budget and Finance, it might be more appropriate to advance your comments, forward your comments to that time.
You're welcome to speak. Next speaker. Welcome, and please introduce yourself.
Good evening. My name is Sherry Anthes. I'd like to thank you for your time. I'll be very brief. Thank you very much, Councilman Gonzalez. I appreciate that. That was actually my request. First, I would like to acknowledge some friends in the room. Realtors, would you please raise your hands? My name is Sherry Anthes again. I am a broker associate for Coldwell Banker. Been in the business about 15 years. I'm also a member of the association, and I really come to you tonight. They said to give my bio. I want my bio to be that I'm a realtor, and I swear by a code of ethics. And I swear by a code of ethics that whenever I enter into someone's home, I carry a fiduciary relationship into that home with that seller. But more importantly, I carry the same fiduciary relationship to the buyer who walks into that transaction later and decides they want to enter into negotiations to purchase that home. Every realtor in this room swears by that same code and carries that same obligation and relationship. What we've discovered, very surprisingly actually to me, when I sent out a request to my own little company, about 160 agents, I was overwhelmed. I still have yet to print all of the emails and all of the stories similar to what you just heard. Some of them will break your heart. I shared most of them with many of you, but I had a new one today. A young lady of the tender age of 80 came into our office, and she's losing her home because she has a new roof. She was asking for a reverse mortgage. The roof on a 1,700 square foot home, $10,000 to $15,000 max. Her tax liability has been increased by $5,500 a year. She's on a fixed income of $1,400. We can't help her. She's not qualified for a reverse mortgage. She cannot pay off the debt, and she will probably lose her home. That is my newest story this afternoon at 3 o'clock. And I have dozens and dozens and dozens more, as do almost every realtor in the room. I appreciate the opportunity to speak. I think it's important that we reassess. And I also would like to acknowledge the fact that I don't think any of us expected to be here where we are today. I know I didn't. When I first heard the program, and I've watched the PowerPoints, and they're beautiful, and they're promising, and they're very interesting and engaging, and really gave hope for an idea that would be wonderful for the community. Where we are today is not that promising. It's predatory, it's damaging, and it's going to have a long and far-lasting effect on the current homeowner. So I appreciate your time. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Anthes. Madam Clerk, next speaker.
Yes, Jean Radzik, same item, same side.
Welcome. Please introduce yourself.
Thank you. Good evening, Mayor Goh, Vice Mayor Smith, and City Council members. Thank you. My name is Jean Radzik. I am a realtor of 29 years, and I'm speaking on behalf of the Bakersfield Association of Realtors, not just our 1,800-plus members, but the homeowners of Bakersfield that are your constituents. We're seeing a troubling trend in the marketplace that Sherry just addressed for you, and it is as a result of the pace lien. It is not about energy or not being green, not wanting to be green. It's about the fact that these things attach to the taxes. These people are absolutely unwitting what they're signing into. Solar is not a bad item. Neither are energy efficient windows and a multitude of other things that we can all do. But having this attached to their tax bill, these people are being led to believe it is a free government program. So they haven't a clue what they're signing. Should they? Of course. We should all read everything. I'd like to wonder how many of you read every piece of the contract the last time you bought a car. But there are situations where this is a good program, where it can help people. But that's not the bulk of what we're seeing. After much consideration, City Council in the past adopted the resolution to allow for this type of financing mechanism to be made available in our marketplace. And we stood silent as realtors. We had no reason to raise any issue. We did not know the unintended consequences. That's where our role has changed. We are here to protect our consumers, to protect the homeowners, to help them understand what they've signed in for. It isn't about me selling a house. I can go sell another house. That is not an issue. It is about the homeowners that are at risk of losing their homes. So we are going to be asking, and as council member has already indicated, that we refer this back to the Budget and Finance Committee, and we would hope that you would follow that up with an action to rescind that resolution. Very much appreciate your leadership and your listening to this problem. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Radzik. Next speaker, please. Madam
Yes,
Clerk.
Our last speaker on the same subject, same side, is Sharon Dickey.
Please come up to the front, Ms. Dickey.
I'm going to wait until the budget.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. All right. The next speakers, the next five speakers would be in support of this item. And the first one would be Dustin Relic.
I had turned in my card, and I wish to speak against this. And so I would like to have that opportunity, Mayor.
And you, are you Mr. Relic?
No.
Okay. We'll have the city clerk read the order of the speakers, and at the appropriate time, you'll be called upon.
Okay. Well, I had turned in the speaker's card, and they told me I didn't need to.
Do you have it, sir? I'll take it.
Oh, thank you.
For or against Mr. Crabtree?
For.
Okay. That's where we were going.
No, I'm sorry. I'm against.
Okay.
I've slept since then.
All right. We'll start again then.
All right.
Our next speaker would be Gary Crabtree, and he is in opposition to this item.
Good evening, Mayor Goh, members of the City Council. My name is Gary Crabtree. I'm here this evening representing the Real Estate Anti-Fraud Coalition, which is also known as REAC. It's comprised of 31 members of the Better Business Bureau, regulatory agencies of the California Department of Real Estate, local appraisers, lenders, title companies, realtors, law enforcement, which includes the Kern County DA's office, the Bakersfield Police Department, the Kern County Sheriff's Department, the local FBI, and the California Bureau of Real Estate. The mission of REAC is to prevent, detect, report real estate fraud through the education and collaboration of law enforcement agencies, and again, education has been directed towards those both. REAC was established in 2012 after the large amount of real estate fraud that had caused a recession from 2009 to 2012, which this community has yet to fully recover from. We support the motion to refer. Thank you, Councilman Gonzalez. We, as REAC members, are concerned about the reports of fraudulent activity by vendors, overcharging homeowners for energy-efficient items, increasing their tax burden to near usurious rates, which have had a negative impact on what is a very tenuous real estate market. In addition to the lack of oversight by any regulatory body. It is our opinion that currently structured, the program will do irreparable harm to the very people it's designed to help. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Crabtree. I thought you looked a lot like Mr. Crabtree. I thought, Thank you. Madam Clerk, next speaker, please.
Now we'll go with Dustin Relic regarding the HERO loan and in support of it.
Thank you.
Welcome, and please introduce yourself.
Thank you. Dustin Relic. I'm the Senior Director of Municipal Development for the HERO program by Renovate America. I have a little packet that I'm going to present for each of you, and I'll explain what that is. And this is just one copy that you can just make part of the
water efficiency. Some good news tonight for Bakersfield from
Some good news tonight for Bakersfield from the HERO program.
No volume.
Public-private
on it.
Partnership between Bakersfield.
Well, I'm going to go ahead and speak. We represent the HERO program, and I'd like to, since there's going to be limited time for us to speak, I'd like anyone that is here in favor of PACE in our community, that are homeowners as well as local contractors that are stimulating local jobs, to please stand, like much of the realtors spoke. These are people that live in your neighborhood here in Bakersfield, and they're providing local jobs, stimulating local jobs by utilizing the HERO program to be able to help homeowners. There's homeowners in the audience. There are contractors in the audience that are really helping your community. Now, things have changed with PACE over time. Obviously, when it started, there were some challenges, and I submitted some things to you so that you each have all of the different contractor compliance things that have to be abided by on the left side, and then all of the disclosure forms and so forth are on the right side, as well as all of our real estate transaction components so that you actually know how to work through a real estate transaction. In the legislation, in the legislature, in this last session, AB 2693 was a collaborative effort that was put forward originally by the realtors to kill PACE. But what happened is we collaboratively worked together to come to an agreement to create a lot of disclosures and a lot of things around PACE that all went into effect January 1st of 2017, all but eliminating every problem that there could have been around PACE. To this day, now, because of AB 2693. It's a simple form, a three-page disclosure form with all the totals of financing costs, the closing costs. We also do all of the interest rates are very out in the open and initialed next to, and there's disclosures that we go through on the phone with the constituent. We actually do 100% confirmed term calls with every single homeowner to make sure that they understand what the terms of that agreement are. They're not being taken advantage of by your contractors. Your contractors that are registered in the HERO program today are actually stepping up the bar. They're raising the bar for consumer protection, and our company is leading the way with that. I look forward to the referral. I look forward to the referral to the committee and being able to discuss all of those factors before you in the near future. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Raleigh.
Some good news tonight for Bakers.
Madam Clerk, next.
Brian McCarty, private partnership. Same item.
Welcome. Please introduce yourself.
Thank you, Madam Mayor, City Council. Thanks for the opportunity to speak. I'll make it quick. We have a lot of people that want to talk tonight. I'm the Kern County Account Manager for the HERO program. I've been in this job 27 months. I'm local. I've lived here about 10 years. Daughter at Frontier. Wife teaches in Panama, Buena Vista, so I'm local. I wanted to just say that I was in the Army for 4 years, military police investigator, and a criminal investigator for 15 years. My integrity is non-negotiable. My ethics are not as well. The company I work for feels the same way. I think very quickly, what's happened with PACE is that there are other PACE providers that are flooding in here. Every other month, I hear about a new PACE program from Los Angeles or somewhere else. And the fact that they don't have a track record or maybe the consumer protections that HERO does, these things happen to homeowners, which, you know, obviously we don't like. I just wanted to read briefly a letter from a local homeowner that I'm going to submit to the city clerk. I don't want to give her identity here, but her information's here. You can contact her to speak with her personally. Dear Mayor Goh and Bakersfield City Council members, I'm writing to support the HERO program of Bakersfield. It is a step in the right direction and affords individuals the opportunity to be a part of a growing eco-friendly community. The HERO program allowed me, with a less than perfect credit score, to have solar panels installed on my roof. I have since sold that property. At that time, I learned of another benefit of the program, which was payment flexibility. I was able to pay off the remaining balance with the money I received from the sale of the house, providing the buyers an incentive for the purchase. Neither I nor my buyers were hassled with any further issues. It was a very simple process. I plan on using the HERO program once again for my new home, so it can too have solar panels. When the benefits are so great and there is no harm done to existing businesses, it makes good sense to support the HERO program. Please feel free to contact me should you have any further questions or comments, and I'll give that to the city clerk. I thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mr. McCarty. Madam Clerk.
Mr. Kent Banner regarding the same item. Thank you.
Mr. Banner? Would those of you who are going to be speaking on this topic make your way to the front in the front row, please? Welcome, and please introduce yourself.
Good evening. My name is Kent Guerrero. I own Banner Air Conditioning here in town. And first off, I want to thank you guys for your service to the community. I believe if there's any, I've heard the word fraudulent scams brought up, and I've got all the respect for the fellow people in the real estate business and Gary Crabtree. They're all respectable in the community. But I think you can't blame the program for the fraud. If there's any kind of overcharging going on, I mean, that's going to happen whether somebody goes to their own bank and gets a second on their house or any other kind of loans that are available other than the PACE program. You're always going to have companies that are just off the charts charging things. And so if the homeowner's not diligent in getting three competitive bids, they're going to get stung, you know, or pay more for a product than they should. We've used the program. It's a great program. All of our customers are happy. I myself have used the program on solar, and when I went to do a refi, it came right up that I had that. Whether you want to call it a second or a tax lien, same difference. So I'm not sure how these other people end up selling a house without it showing up. I feel bad for them, but in my case, it didn't, and it's a great program. So, I support it, and I think it would be a big job killer if the council took it off the table, because it brings a lot of revenue to the local contractors. You know, and right now with the housing boom is still down, and we need all the support we can. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Banner. We have just
one more speaker.
One more speaker. Okay.
Mr. Mark DeVries, same side.
Good evening, Mayor Goh and council members. I'm here to support the PACE programs tonight. This has been very successful for us to grow our business. It's also given our customers the ability to provide energy upgrades to their homes. In addition to that, it's really caused us to go to a higher standard that HERO and California First and these other PACE providers require. So I just want to let you know that I'm here in support of that tonight, and I appreciate your time. Thank you.
Thank you. Madam Clerk, I think we have a few more speakers on this topic.
I actually have four more, Mayor. I just had another card handed in to me. So the next one would be Scott Gurnett.
Welcome, and please introduce yourself.
Good evening, Mayor, Council. I'd just like to speak for the PACE programs. And I'm a local contractor. My name's Scott Gurnett. I own, co-own Divine Power USA. Since this program that we're very grateful was brought to the city of Bakersfield, we've been able to add about 20 employees to our company, and this has really opened up some doors for our company and for our customers. We believe it is a very well-ran program. I'm really kind of in shock and awe that these homeowners have had the problems that they have had, because we haven't seen any of that, and we've done dozens of PACE loans, and we've yet to see any problems like this. So disclosure seems like an issue that maybe needs to be repaired to make the realtors happy, but I don't think the program needs to be thrown out. I think it's a wonderful program. It promotes energy efficiencies for people that have trouble being able to go and use standard means of borrowing money to do those energy upgrades. So again, I just want to speak in support of the PACE program. I think it's a great program. And I think that it was well thought of when it was brought to the state of California, and I would certainly sorely miss it if it was removed. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Burnett. We have just about 5 minutes left and three speakers, so you might want to pace yourself. Madam Clerk?
Yes, Tracy Tate.
Welcome. Please introduce yourself.
Thank you, and thank you, council members. My name is Tracy Tate, and I'm a regional community engagement manager for our Hero Property Advisors team for Renovate America. And our Hero Property Advisors team, we do outreach, a proactive outreach to the real estate community associations and our Hero homeowners. We also assist lenders, title, officers, escrow agents, and we work very closely with these individuals to assist them and guide them through a Hero real estate transaction. I personally work out in the field, and the Kern County and Bakersfield area is part of my territory, and I personally reach out to associations, building relationships, supplying them with educations, helping them to understand what Hero is, what it does, and how I can help them and provide them with tools, resources, education, and correct information about the Hero program. I even have letters of endorsements from associations from in California that have been to our Hero presentation, and what a benefit it has been for them to have this education. I'm personally passionate about this and education to help. I am too a realtor, one of five generations, so I walk and talk realtor. Okay, so I understand the frustrations realtors and homeowners have. So from my heart, I just want to help. We provide the education, we have TRID-like disclosures, and we make 100% confirmed term callouts to every homeowner who chooses Hero. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Ms. Tate. Madam Clerk, next public speaker.
Thank you, Don Lanier.
Good evening. Don Lanier, and I run a company called Northwest Exteriors, local contractor here in town. And so I'll tell you a little bit about what how has been a beneficial to our company and the community. You guys originally voted Hero or any of the PACE programs in order to create jobs, to help homeowners improve their homes, also to help the energy efficiency and to help bring down the greenhouse emissions. And also to, most importantly, to help the homeowners improve their quality of life. Since the Hero program and the PACE programs came about in 2014, our company went from $1.7 million annually to about approximately 7 to 8 employees. Since then, we're at $4.1 million annually. We now have 25 employees and are in the process of hiring 6 more. These employees that we hire are able to feed their families, to purchase homes, purchase vehicles. It's also stimulating the economy through more products being bought in the local communities. And also, one of the biggest things that we need to look at is the homeowner. People say may have a low income that cannot afford to replace their air conditioning in the middle of the summer when their air conditioning goes out and it's 100 degrees. If your grandparents had their home, their air conditioning's fallen out in the middle of the summer, has no means to finance it, no cash, and the PACE programs is their only alternative. It is a great program, and we fully disclose everything at the point of sale, and I just think that eliminating the PACE programs will definitely take a huge hit in this community. We already took a huge hit with the oil field crisis. People are moving out of this state because of it and the county. And we're building the construction industry back up to an awesome standards. And also we're doing our part in reducing the greenhouse emissions. And as unfortunately, we all know that Bakersfield is the number one or number two worst air quality in the country. You eliminate the PACE programs, we're going to continue to be in this predicament. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lanier. Madam Clerk?
Our last speaker for 1 minute is George, and I won't insult you by slaughtering your last name.
Apostolopoulos, first name George, thank you. Madam Mayor, members of the council, my name is George Apostolopoulos. I'm with the Y Green Works PACE program, administered by Y Green Energy Fund, and I'm here to give you an update on how well the program has been performing here in the city of Bakersfield. And keep in mind, these PACE programs are another option that your property owners have in making those improvements, those energy and water saving improvements to their homes. So it's a great option to have, and what that's done so far here in the city of Bakersfield, over 633 property owners have taken advantage of this program, which means that they've actually funded, and you're looking at close to 200 new and sustainable jobs created from our program, which has resulted in a $30 million stimulus to your local economy. And in regards to everything else that energy efficiency does and what PACE programs do, when you start looking at the amount of water that's been saved, close to 51 million gallons of water have been saved in your community. 14,073 metric tons of CO2 have been reduced from the atmosphere. And what that means is, I mean, it's about 80,000 homes that can be powered for a whole year. So when you start looking at these metrics as a whole, it's a great option to have for your constituents, which maybe they wouldn't have been able to do if it was a different form of financing. So we urge you to continue with the programs. We're here for Councilmember Gonzalez with the committee. We'll be more than happy to attend and discuss this with you further. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Madam Clerk, next item.
Our next item is Workshop 6A, Events at Bright House Networks Amphitheater. Email correspondence was received by Dan Brito and Carrie Wobe.
Just take a minute for us to clear the chambers, and then we'll have Mr. Tandy proceed.
Yes.
Thank you all for coming forward tonight and sharing your comments. We appreciate it. Mr. Tandy, anytime you're ready.
Honorable Mayor and members of City Council, thank you. Yesterday, the Community Services Committee met and listened to a presentation on this issue, and the two members of that committee present, Vice Mayor Smith and Council Member Sullivan, did vote to recommend to City Council the staff recommendation. Bright House Networks Amphitheater has been undergoing a lot of changes the last several years to make it more economically viable to have acts perform here and to have higher level acts than were originally the case. Actually, a part of the contract for the Anschutz Entertainment Group, or AEG, to manage our various facilities included a cash payment which paid for portable restrooms and a ticket booth and some other improvements at the amphitheater. Additional improvements have involved enhanced concession capability, improvements to seating. We negotiated an improved naming rights deal with Bright House, and the naming rights revenues are dedicated to underwriting some of the cost of having artists perform there. The quality of the acts have increased significantly. Last year, for example, Lynyrd Skynyrd, Ziggy Marley, Kenny Rogers, and the Beach Boys all appeared. And next slide, please. And the problem that is the subject of tonight's discussion is depicted here. This is not inside the amphitheater. This is outside. And this occurred at the Beach Boys show and virtually surrounded the amphitheater. Now the problem is that private sector interests take financial risks to put these acts on,
And when the private sector interest, who is taking the financial risk, sees 600 people outside the gates not paying, not buying concessions, and they don't do as well as they'd hope to do financially, they're not likely to come back anymore. So this is a problem that, when we were doing lesser acts, was only modest in nature. As we have improved the quality of the acts, it has gotten more and more severe. Our current manager for our venues from AEG is Steve Eckerson. Since Mr. Eckerson arrived here, we have booked at the arena Blake Shelton, which is a sellout for Thursday night, Elton John, which is a sellout in March, Tim McGraw and Faith Hill, who will sell out in September, and Lady Antebellum, who is likely to sell out in May. So Mr. Eckerson understands the business that he helps manage our facilities for, and he came up with this idea that enhances security at the events. The performers don't like people to have access to their backstage area. And it is to close on 3 hours prior to performances the area encircled in red. It's about half of the park at Riverwalk. There is a playground outside of the closed area and an entire additional lake and picnicking area moving over towards Stockdale Highway. So 6 or 8 days a year, 3 hours before the show, this would be posted as closed, and people could walk in and out, but they could not do what was depicted in that earlier film and park outside of the arena and listen to the concert for free. I would like Mr. Eckerson to come up and talk a bit from his perspective about this circumstance, if he would.
Thank you. First of all, I've been in Bakersfield 6 months, and it's a pleasure to be here. I'm enjoying it, happy to be here. As Mr. Tandy pointed out, one of the challenges we're having is an area where a considerable number of residents are congregating and enjoying the shows without paying. That is creating two challenges for us. One, in attracting acts and promoters to take risk. We've had a couple of promoters that have visited the amphitheater, and the first thing they ask me is, what about all these people that are kind of outside of the existing grounds enjoying the show? And the other is some security concerns that Mr. Tandy pointed out, where the backstage area is not secure. So I am here asking that we expand the footprint of the park that we are currently closing. You saw a diagram that's less than half of what's presently being closed off right now.
And with that, staff, our manager from AEG, and the Community Services Committee are recommending that we get council permission to close the portion of the park depicted in the photograph 3 hours before event nights. Happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Mr. Tandy. Vice Mayor?
Thank you, Mayor. Yes, I was on the Community Services Committee and we discussed this yesterday, and I was also at the park when they took that picture and walked through the crowd. And like I stated yesterday, I love free concerts, and I think it'd be great if the city could provide free concerts, but that's not the situation we're in. And the situation we're in is that we're trying to provide a community asset and quality entertainment. And in order to do that, we need to have a venue that can hold the people that are paying for it. So I would move staff's recommendation on this. Thank you.
Councilmember Sullivan.
Thank you, Mayor. Yes, I feel this is very reasonable, very, very appropriate, and I certainly support this also. Thank you.
You have a motion. Please cast your votes.
Motion is unanimously approved.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Next item, please, Madam Clerk.
Yes, we have our consent calendar items 8A through 8, I believe it's X or Z. Thank you.
Vice Mayor?
Does any council member wish to recuse themselves for any items? Seeing none, does any council member wish to pull any items for separate consideration? Seeing none, then I will make a motion to approve items 8A through Z. Thank you.
You have a motion. Please cast your votes.
Motion is unanimously approved.
Thank you, Madam Clerk. Next item, please.
We have no consent calendar hearings. Our next item will be hearing item 10A, a resolution making findings and updating the capital improvement plan for the existing Metropolitan Habitat Bakers Conservation Plan. First reading was given January 4th, 2017.
Before I open the public hearing, I'll go over the presentation time policy. Each side will be allowed 15 minutes. It's 15 minutes for all speakers, so it's important that you identify yourself, make your statement quickly, so that others may speak. We'll hear statements from those opposed to the staff recommendation, then we'll hear from those who would like to speak in favor of the staff recommendation. If there's testimony on both sides, each side will be allowed a 5-minute rebuttal. There's a clock on the wall behind me, which indicates the 15 minutes. Please step to the microphone, identify yourself, and after 14 minutes, a yellow light will come on. At the end of 15 minutes, a red light will flash, indicating your time is up, so quickly end your statement. You may ask questions during your statement, but they won't be answered until the public hearing is closed. If you have written statements that are longer than your verbal statements, give them to the clerk, please, and she'll provide copies to the council. Please be courteous to others who wish to speak. Unless there's approval by the majority of the city council, there's a strict 15-minute limit for all those in favor or opposition to staff's recommendation. So please be concise and avoid repeating the remarks of the previous speaker. Ms. Kitchen?
Thank you, Mayor. First, we'll hear item 10A, and this is a simple annual request that's before your council every year to update the capital improvement plan that's associated with the Metropolitan Bakersfield Habitat Conservation Plan. This plan, as you all know, has been in place since 1994 for the purpose of streamlining compliance with the Endangered Species Act and ensuring compliance with the regulations of the federal and state habitat conservation agencies. The current fee is not being changed this year. It's been effective. It will remain at $21.45 an acre. And since 1994, these fees have been used to acquire over 24,000 acres of habitat to offset over 22,000 acres of development. Therefore, we have remained in compliance once again with our 1-to-1 ratio, is what that slide should say, not 1-to-0. And so we are recommending no changes, and our staff recommendation is that your council make a motion to approve and adopt the resolution.
Thank you, Ms. Kitchen. At this time, I'll open the public hearing. Is there anyone who would like to speak in opposition? If so, please come to the microphone and identify yourself and proceed. Seeing none, is there anyone who wishes to speak in support or in favor? Please step to the mic if so. And seeing none, I'll close the public hearing and return it to council for comment and action. Vice Mayor?
I would move to approve and adopt the resolution.
You have a motion. Please cast your votes.
Motion is unanimously approved.
Madam Clerk, please read the next public hearing item.
Hearing item 10B is an appeal by the neighbors for a safe Valley Plaza of the January 10th, 2017 decision of the BZA to approve a conditional use permit to allow alcohol sales and consumption in a movie theater located at 2000 Weibel Road.
Ms. Kitchen?
Yes.
Thank you, Mayor, Council. Clerk, can we put up the screen, please? It was the other PowerPoint, the one that we were previously in. Thank you. Okay, so this project is a request to allow for the sale and alcohol or in consumption of alcohol at the Reading Cinema Movie Theater, which is an existing 16 auditorium theater located adjacent to the Valley Plaza Mall. As you can see from this aerial, surrounding properties consist of the mall to the north, multifamily and single family to the east and to the south, and additional retail to the west. The site is currently zoned C2, and there is single family and multifamily zoning located to the south and the east. The C2 zone does allow for movie theaters and standalone restaurants that sell alcohol. However, a CUP is required for alcohol sales within a movie theater. This application was submitted to staff in November by Michael Ayes of liquorlicense.com on behalf of Reading Cinemas, and this request is specifically for the theater shown here at the Valley Plaza Mall. However, staff was also advised that there may be other applications submitted in the near future. Upon receipt of the application, we confirm that this request is the first of its type within the city of Bakersfield. So we identified a need to analyze and assess this request carefully, and we conducted research on similar operations in other cities and were able to locate several independent and corporate theaters that sell alcohol predominantly located in the Southern California area. Some examples of those include the Studio Movie Grill, which has two locations in Southern California, as well as locations in Arizona and in the Midwest. And according to their website, these theaters include upgraded seating and tables, and upon arrival, patrons check in with a lounge area to verify their age and IDs, and then go directly to a reserved seat where there is a push button seat service function. And from there, a server would deliver alcoholic beverages and food directly to that seat. Another example is Sinopolis. This chain has 7 locations in California. Of those 7, 5 are considered to be the luxury brand that include alcohol sales. The website shows that these are a kind of boutique style, and they typically consist of 6 to 8 auditoriums with a limited number of seatings ranging from 65 to 80 seats per theater with the reclining function and the upgraded seating. So that is in comparison to their other 2 theaters, which are the more traditional style, large stadium seating, and those do not include alcohol sales. Another example is the ArcLight Theaters. These are located in the Los Angeles area, San Diego, as well as Chicago and Boston. And according to their website, alcohol service is limited only to those auditoriums that are fully dedicated as 21 plus. So throughout our research, we found also several independent theaters and some corporate theaters, such as AMC, that include alcohol sales in some of their locations throughout the country. And we did notice a few themes. Though the businesses varied from location to location, it was pretty apparent that most of the theaters that included alcohol sales included upgraded seating, as shown on that top photograph there. They were usually in smaller auditoriums and included a direct seat service function where a server came to your chair within the theater. There were also some theaters that included dedicated 21 plus auditoriums or that had a physically separated area for alcohol sales, as shown in that bottom photo there. And what we concluded is that really was a case-by-case analysis needed that was based on the venue and what was being proposed. So the request that's before us tonight is to add alcohol sales to the Valley Plaza Theater. And that theater is a traditional style theater. I'm sure we're all familiar with it. It has 16 auditoriums ranging in size from 99 to 465 seats, as well as 2 concession areas, one in the front before the ticketing area and one in the back after you've provided a movie ticket. The applicant's request to staff was to allow for the service and consumption of beer, wine, and distilled spirits in all 16 auditoriums, the lobby area, as well as throughout the premises, as well as the addition of service counters and kiosks for the sale of food and alcohol throughout the premises. So as a part of the application, the applicant also indicated that they would adhere to certain operational procedures that were part of their branded corporate policies. And those include the requirement for patrons to wear a wristband if they are going to consume alcohol, and that employees would go into the 16 auditoriums once every 30 minutes to do a visual check of the auditorium, and that they may not leave the premises with alcoholic beverages. So based on the research that was conducted by staff throughout the state and in consultation with the Bakersfield Police Department, and the fact that this is the first theater in Bakersfield of this type, staff recommended a limited conditional use permit approval that would allow alcohol sales in three theaters only and subject to several operational conditions that are highlighted here. So in addition to the limit to the three theaters only, sales would also be limited to the back concession area to allow for better enforcement of the standards that would be required by the ABC permit. There were, in consultation with the police department, who I forgot to mention is also here tonight to answer any questions, we also included several of the conditions of approval that are typically put on a cabaret permit, and those are related to the requirement for a specific number of security guards and an on-site manager at all times that's 21 or over. There was also conditions related to employee training and sign limitations. So when we received the application on November 1st and scheduled it for the next available BZA hearing, which was December 13th, and at that hearing, comments were received from three local residents who expressed concerns with the potential availability of alcohol to minors that could be associated with the sale in all 16 theaters, and it concerns that these activities could aggravate the number of assaults in an area that's already a high crime area. So due to the complexity of the project and interest of the public, staff recommended that the request be continued to the January board hearing, which it was. At the January board hearing, two residents also appeared and expressed similar comments in opposition, with one resident expressing that he was there to represent a group of 20 neighborhood watch individuals. At that hearing, the applicant requested that the board consider changes to staff's recommendation, including increasing the number of theaters back to all 16 as they had originally requested, and reducing the ratio of private security personnel to a fixed number of four, as well as several other operational conditions. And the conditions that were requested are included in your board report with the changes from the applicant highlighted. The BZA voted to approve the project pursuant to the changes requested by the applicant by a vote of 2-1, and a list of, again, of those revisions is included in your packet. On January 18th, the city received an appeal by the neighbors for Safe Valley Plaza, and that is what we are considering here tonight. In their appeal, the appellants state that the consumption of alcohol at Reading Cinemas will lead to potential negative effects to the surrounding community, including criminal activity, intoxicated driving, loitering, and vandalism. So tonight your council is considering whether or not to approve the CUP. Because the decision of the BZA was a final action and it was not a recommendation to your council, staff is not obligated to bring that decision back to you tonight as our recommendation. So I should note that the city understands the desire of existing movie theater chains to compete and to adjust their operations to fit with the evolving needs of customers. And we understand that there's a lot of evolving technology, all the alternative venues to view movies, whether that be in a personal home theater, through a streaming device, on a personal device, et cetera. We understand that. And we want to support that need for those theaters to compete. However, given that this is the first request of its type within the city, and that similar operations in Southern California include specific themed, highlighted operational conditions that I highlighted earlier, staff's recommendation tonight remains unchanged, and it's the same as it was to the BZA for that limited number of theaters. In this case, at the Valley Plaza, as you can see here on the map, the sales are being proposed in an existing traditional style theater. It is not one of the smaller boutique style theaters. Seat service is not a part of the current proposal as presented by staff. So we would recommend that the limited duration be the first approval. And then should the theater prove to be successful, they would have an opportunity to come back to the city and apply for a subsequent CUP to increase their operations in the future. So now your council has several options: to go with staff's recommendation for the three theaters, to go with what the board or the BZA approved for the full facility, or some variation of that, or you could simply deny the request altogether. So with that, I am here to answer questions, and I should also note that Paul Johnson, the principal planner from my department, is here, and he was instrumental in working with the applicant through this, as well as Lieutenant Mattson from the police department to answer any questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Kitchen. At this time, I'll open the public hearing. We have 15 minutes for each side. Is there anyone who'd like to speak in opposition? If so, please come forward to the microphone and identify yourself and proceed.
Good evening, Honorable Mayor, members of the council. My name is Michael Ayaz, A-Y-A-Z. I represent the Reading Cinema Theater. Just a few matters of housekeeping. Some of the slides and information that were provided to you this evening were not provided to the applicant. And so for purposes of the administrative record, I want to make that clear. We weren't provided with any of the documentations or slides, or and the staff report was silent on some of the issues that were just discussed by Ms. Kitchen. Secondly, the Board of Zoning Administrators did in fact approve the request, and it is our position that the city has in effect shifted the burden of proof from the appellants, who have filed the appeal and have now taken it upon themselves to go backwards from the decision makers that had already made the decision. And procedurally, we think that's a violation of our due process and equal rights. But having said that, legal stuff, getting that out of the way, we want to talk to you about our project. And the Board of Zoning Administrators understood that the concept of the three limited auditoriums was one that would be very difficult to be successful. The staff allows us, per their recommendation and the representations that they made, to shift these three theaters around. And so it creates a very difficult process. But the movie theater business, and what they didn't tell you was there was no theater that they looked at that had a limitation on the auditorium numbers. Generally, most of those auditoriums either had the age, which is where certain movie theaters go, but we are a movie theater, movie purist operation. In other words, we don't have people coming into the movie theater in the middle of your movie to disrupt the movie. Our business is the movie business, and so we don't have that kind of service. And so that's why we've asked for the availability throughout all of our theaters. This is a shot across the bow. I also represent another movie theater that has filed an application within this city very recently that's coming in to do the same exact request. Studio Grill, which one of the slides indicated, that movie theater is also coming in. And so the fact that we are the trailblazer, that we are the first one out the gate, should not be punishable by limiting or strangling us from being able to do the kind of business that we've done successfully across this country. There's not been one citation or revocation or ABC violation in any of our theaters. I've personally provided over 50 theaters to planning staff that have the same similar request, none of which had any ABC violations. This is really a question about development within this community. Not only will this be an amenity that's provided to the residents of this community, it will also require require a tremendous amount of improvements, tenant improvements, investment into this facility, which my client is not new to your community. They've been here since 1999. They have a long-term lease. They pay property taxes. They've employed thousands of your residents over the almost 20 years that they've been here. Getting this will allow them to hire an additional 25 to 35, reaching that number to 100 employees. Per their lease, they pay the property taxes. They do a lot of good things for this community. And tonight, we had the opportunity to hear from many contractors, and it's kind of an interesting topic. But if we are approved, we are going to make tenant improvements to this facility in the realm of multi-million dollars. We've spent $1 million just on the IMAX theater, which is the only IMAX theater within your community. The closest one is 75 miles away, and we have community members that drive to go see movies outside of your city to theaters that offer these type of services. So we've made that investment. That investment is going to give your local contractors jobs. It's going to create additional tax revenue. It's a important decision for you folks to make, because not only will this affect my client, but AMC, Studio Grill, and a number of other theaters that are coming in. We would ask that you consider the appellant's objection to our project. And these were the same exact objections that we had discussed with the Board of Zoning Administrators. And the Board of Zoning Administrators voted in favor of our project. And I was not the one that submitted or modified the conditions. We requested them, staff got up, they came back with conditions, and the Board of Zoning Administrators ultimately approved the document that's before you. And so what we've done is we've provided, because the city did not, a resolution upholding the decision of the Board of Zoning Administrators, because that's what we're seeking. Anything less than that is effectively a denial for our client, because operationally, it doesn't make any sense. Now, because this is the first one that's here, they've added the cabaret conditions. And the cabaret conditions are for nightclubs, they're for places that have live entertainment. You know, they're not for a movie theater. So you see in the cabaret conditions a police force, basically, that is being required. And what we're saying is, look, we will provide a security. And I think Councilmember Parlier was at one time did some security in that mall area, so he's very familiar with that, and actually has had some communications with our clients before. The idea is we want to make this a warm and inviting atmosphere. So I would ask you, just recently you had a 23,000 square foot restaurant bowling alley open up in your community that is family oriented, with a tequila bar upstairs and a large bar downstairs, and it's family oriented. My client is the only client you'll find in the city of Bakersfield, and probably California, that has agreed to limit its service of alcoholic beverages to two drinks per person per day, period. This is not a location where people are going to come get intoxicated. If you've been to a movie, you know the last thing you want to do is get up and go to the bathroom, because you don't want to miss an important part of that movie. That's also why we don't have servers, because we want our people to enjoy the movie theater. So this is not, and a lot of people in the community that we've talked to, they don't understand the conditions that we've agreed to. An operator to limit its ability to make money. And we're doing that because statistically, our client sells 1.1 to 1.2 alcoholic beverages per visit anyways. It's not our primary focus. However, it is a benchmark for us in order to invest the type of money we need to into a theater, to revamp it, to remodel it, and to provide the additional amenities. Now, it's all surrounding alcohol, but that's not it. We're putting in a $250,000 kitchen. We're adding an amazing food menu. We're not just serving popcorn and hot dogs anymore, and that's our goal, because we are competing with the home movie theaters. We are competing with the people that have streaming services and surround sound and luxury seating. So we're adding an extensive menu to complement the movie-going experience. And again, alcohol is a very ancillary component. This is not a unique concept in the movie theater business. We have provided statistical data to the city from the people that keep these statistical datas. I know and I feel that some of you have probably visited movie theaters that have the service, certainly not here, but in other state, other cities within the state. It's something that's unknown but should not be punished. And as, again, I tell you, these things that we're talking about are a very restricted type of activity. We have done this throughout the state without one single incident, without one single violation. And I encourage you, if there was, we would have heard about that. So this is coming to your city, and this is something that your decision tonight is going to ring a bell for other businesses in this community, particularly movie theater businesses, one which is right on the tailcoats of this, and Studio Grill, which is taking over an old car lot and planning on investing likely millions of dollars into that facility. And we're limiting ourselves again to the two drinks. We have a very sophisticated WeScan program, not something that was necessarily discussed, but was discussed at great length during the process. It's a point of sale system that requires an ID every single time an alcoholic beverage is served, and will immediately stop the service after the second swipe when someone has purchased two beverages. I'd also like to, given the time constraints, again, as a matter of public record and administrative record, the city had a long time to kind of do their presentation. We have 15 minutes, so we're trying to get through all this. We've had people travel hundreds of miles to be here today. So in an effort to try to save time, I'd like to provide the council members a presentation that was prepared by our client in the event that we can hopefully get to it, but if not, we have that as part of the record. Again, the idea that you would deny what the Board of Zoning Administrators has already upheld is something that's very foreign to me. I've not seen that. Generally, you support your decision and the appellant has to bear the burden of proof. We think the burden of proof has been inappropriately shifted to us because we made our case, we addressed those concerns. We went through two separate hearings, one hearing so that we could hear from the neighbors and listen to them and then work with Jackie Kitchen and Paul Johnson and PD to try to resolve any concerns. We came back for a second hearing in which we went through the process, and the people that have now appealed did not afford themselves that opportunity. While they have the right, my client has now gone through the ringer to get here tonight, and they're asking for a fair and reasonable decision from you folks, and anything less than what the Board of Zoning Administrators has provided is effectively a denial. It will not allow my client to provide the type of financial investment that it wants to make in this community. It's very recently they're involved in the blood drive. They do Sunday families. I mean, this is a movie theater that is the hub. Now, the police department's going to talk to you about crime statistics. 0.4%. 0.4, not even half of a percent of the calls for services generated in that entire reporting district are from this location. 0.4, and not even half of a percent. So the problems aren't the movie theater. The problem that surrounds that community is that it remains undeveloped, and it needs people and big companies to come in, like my client, who are supporting tax revenue, who are supporting money for roads and jobs and things like that that we've heard about a lot tonight. My client is doing that. So with that, I really would implore you to take the BZA's decision and approve it as it stands and allow us to come in. We've agreed to certain conditions that we wouldn't normally agree to because we understand that this is a case of first impression. But so was Santa Monica, and so was Norwalk, and so were the other cases that were referenced, and they didn't have these type of restrictions. They have a full auditorium. We are only selling from our back concession stand. We're not doing service. We are in line with what is going on in the rest of this country as well as the state. I've spoken to some of you. I really appreciate the time that you have taken to give this consideration. At this moment, I rightfully have to turn it over to Ken, who's our operations guy, and he can talk to you a little bit more about the WeScan system and the safeguards that we put in place. And again, I would implore you, anything short of the BZA's decision is going to kill this project and likely other projects that are coming behind it. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Is there just one speaker left?
Yes.
Yes, thank you.
Hello, I'm Ken Gillich. I drove up from San Diego. Thank you for being here to listen to me. 2:46. All right, here we go. Just a couple things as you're flipping through the packet. I am, in our company, I'm the Senior Director of Food and Beverage. I am the foremost expert in our company about WeScan. If you have questions, I'll be here to answer them on that. But I wanted to talk to you about what we do operationally. Part of this multi-million dollar renovation involves us losing seats. So you saw a slide said 3,200 seats. We're going to go down to 1,500 seats. That's less than 100 per auditorium. So that is a small auditorium on average. So we are going to have smaller houses. They're going to be the nice luxury recliners, everything that our community is asking for, they're demanding for all across the nation. And it's clear in Bakersfield they want it as well. Job creation was touched upon. Just want to share with you, it's not only construction jobs, local contractors, things of that nature. It's not only expanding our staff by, 35-40%, but it's the type of jobs we're bringing in. We're bringing in skilled kitchen workers, knife skills, chef skills. It's not just sweeping up an auditorium like I did. I've been doing this for, over 20 years. I've been in the movie business. I tore tickets, all right? The individuals that we have working for us go on to great things. We just lost a person in one of our locations in Virginia. left us, great employee, fantastic in the kitchen, terrible to see him go, but I was very honored and pleased that he went on to open up his own food truck, and he stayed within his community. And now he's contributing his own, he's got to learn how to pay taxes, business taxes, train employees, and do his own thing on that. But those are skills that he started off where I did, tearing tickets, sweeping theaters, had a passion for food that he didn't know he had, and now he's on to bigger and better things. And we see that all across our 9 locations currently that are selling alcohol, like Mike said, 15 plus years, 9 locations, 0 incidents on that. We take a lot of pride in being a member of the community and giving back to the community. I noticed Safe Surrender got their proclamation, and they mentioned they're going to be showing ads in movie theaters. We're very pleased to be one of those movie theaters that will be showing their ads to educate that. We, you know, for us, it's a reflection that movies are a place to congregate for a lot of people to go to. We understand it's a family-friendly environment, and we would never do anything to damage that. The biggest thing I'm proud of is our food. We talk a lot about alcohol. I wish I could bring a burger up that we sell, but our food is what got us the Best Movie Theater in San Diego award and the Best Entertainment Venue in San Diego. It's the food, the food, the food, the food, and maybe the chairs and the movies, but it's the food. Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Thank you very much. Is there anybody who would like to speak in favor, in support? If so, please make your way forward. Seeing none, whoops, I'm sorry. Come on forward. Please introduce yourself. Welcome.
Welcome. My name is Noel Pinio, and I've been listening to the presentation, and I think that you should approve the 16 theater, 2-drink minimum. I think the gentleman in question did an excellent job of showing that this is a benefit to our community. So I just wanted you to know that opinion. I think you did a fine job of presenting it. I think this would be a real asset to our community. Thank you much.
Thank you, Mr. Pinio. Is there anybody else who would like to speak in favor? In favor of staff recommendation, that is. Please step forward at this time. Seeing none, is there anybody who would like to rebut in opposition? You'll get 5 minutes more, the 5 minutes you really wanted.
I just wanted to show you the commitment. Terry Moore is here, Ken is here, the manager, Jenny, who's been with the company since the beginning is here. You know, we are committed to this community, and we just want to show you that we are serious, we haven't had issues, we will comply with the terms of the BZA condition, and we will make you proud. It's not as scary as it sounds initially. Again, that 2-drink minimum is a key component of that issue. And I just wanted to give Terry an opportunity, because she came all the way down here, and I would feel remiss if she didn't get to introduce herself, at least to the honorable council members and the honorable mayor.
Thank you very much. I was really excited to have the opportunity to present our presentation to all of you here today, because I was actually here the very first day we did the first heap of soil for the Reading Cinemas Valley Plaza Theater. I was here, and I was here during the entire construction, and I'm really proud, and I enjoyed being in Bakersfield, and we've always had such a soft spot for this theater. It's so great, and the community has been so great to us. And I think everybody deserved the opportunity to sit in these great seats and for us to spend millions of dollars to do the renovation. But like we said throughout the day, it sort of depends on whether we can get this license and make it happen for us. But I've had so many great experiences with employees that have gone through our theaters over the years. And like I said, Jenny's here, and she's been here since the beginning. And we have a great and loyal staff that works for us. And I will tell you that we are very good at what we do. We've never had any instances. And I think we have great theaters throughout the country, and we do this often. And I have confidence in us. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Is there anyone who would like to rebut in support of staff's recommendation? Seeing none, I'll close the public hearing and return it to council for comment and action. Councilmember Parlier, would you like to start?
Thank you, Mayor. I'm just going to kind of go down the list as things were brought up. And first of all, I want to state that I do know Jenny. We haven't talked in quite a while, but last time I did talk to you, I mean, she's a great person. She is an effective manager there, and you do have a good employee. Now, it was brought up regarding they weren't provided the provided materials by staff. Ms. Kitchen, could you address that? Were materials provided to the applicant?
Yes, Councilmember Parlier, with the exception of the PowerPoint, which we don't typically provide, it's a series of images, but the admin report, the resolution, staff's recommended conditions of approval were all provided to the applicant.
Okay. Can you also re-explain the BZA and why that's not binding?
Certainly, the city attorney can help me out if she would like, but essentially, the BZA's action on a conditional use permit is considered final and standing unless it is appealed to your council. So therefore, staff is not required to bring their decision forward as a recommendation, as we would be if, for example, the Planning Commission made a recommendation to your council on a zone change. That recommendation we would be required to bring forward to your council as the recommendation.
Okay, so that
Mayor, Councilmember Parlier, if I could just supplement that response. I think another way of looking at it in terms of legal mumbo jumbo is that your council has the opportunity to look at the decision from the BZA in a de novo review. In other words, you can look to what happened at the BZA for the facts, but you are able to review it free and clear without any type of burden of proof going into this hearing.
Okay, so what you're saying is we're the final deciders and policymakers on this, correct?
That's correct.
Okay, thank you. The applicant brought up Studio Grill as an example of another theater that is proposed coming into Bakersfield. Are we talking apples to apples on that, or is it apples to oranges as far as what that venue wants to do compared to, let's say, the Reading Cinema?
Sure, Council Member Parlier through the mayor. That application just came to staff and was just submitted to the city very recently. So we're still working with that applicant to see what the details of their operation would be. But based on the research of Studio Movie Grill that we've seen so far, and some of which was shown to you tonight, that is a different scenario where it's build to suit. And there is a more limited number of theaters, smaller venue, seat service, the larger chairs as a part of the initial build. And that will be known from the get-go, which would be different than an existing movie theater. And what has been presented to staff up to this point is that there wouldn't be any change to the current theater at Reading. However, the applicants indicated tonight that they would do some upgrades if this was approved. So we know that now.
Okay, thank you. The applicant also stated regarding their desire to do extensive tenant improvements, but there's nothing that we can do within a CUP process that would be binding or require them to do that?
Well, you could include conditions of approval that specify the number of seats in a theater or which theaters that this activity can occur in, and those conditions of approval would need to be complied with before any operations for related to alcohol sales occurred. So you could get fairly specific if you wanted to.
Okay, thank you. Lieutenant Mattson, could you come up front, please?
Good evening.
Thank you, sir. It was brought up that the theater falls within a high crime area. Can you explain that a little bit and maybe give some examples of what kind of challenges the police department has in that area?
Absolutely. Good evening, Madam Mayor, council members. We looked at a couple of different areas trying to look at footprints of where current theaters exist. We looked at the Valley Plaza. Currently, we looked at the year 2016 only. It had 1,571 calls for service. With that, there was 454 Part 1 crimes. And a Part 1 crime is a reporting crime of a, we look at different areas of aggravated assault, rape, robbery, burglary, larceny, and theft would qualify as Part 1 crimes. And so in our assessment of that for the Valley Plaza, we did note that the predominant crimes were theft-related in that footprint of the Valley Plaza and the surrounding area, to include Reading Theater, as well as auto theft. But there were 13 robberies reported in that footprint of the Valley Plaza, including that area, as well as aggravated assaults. There were 3 reported. And with regards to specific incidents, probably the most recent one that would kind of give an idea of what the type of crime in that area is about 2 days ago on the 13th, officers were dispatched into that area to the Valley Plaza itself, specifically dealing with reports of subjects being armed with firearms, loitering in and around the business complex there. Officers did make contact. They did end up arresting 2 gang members, both in possession of firearms, and one of those firearms being reported stolen from some burglary-type offenses. So when we look at this, we look at the totality as a public safety issue, not just what occurs within a facility, but often with these places, with the Valley Plaza, there is loitering that goes in and around with all the different establishments. There's a lot of loitering that goes through the parking lots as well. So in this type of assessment, we wanted to take a look at the totality of that footprint when we were reporting out the crime statistics. Because any one individual location, it would be hard to make a nexus of one specific incident to a business, unless you're looking at things such as theft. So if you're looking at a totality, especially as it deals with violent crime, often people come to a particular location for the purposes of going to a mall or going to a restaurant or going to a movie theater or going to a shop or something else, but it's the ancillary when they start loitering around, walking to and from their vehicles or loitering in the parking lots for the purposes thereof of associating with friends in a common place, that there is additional public safety factors. So that was the type of consideration that we took when we were looking at this footprint.
Can you tell me if those gang members, were they old enough to purchase alcoholic beverages?
Sir, if I can refer, I'll take a quick look at the report. One was reported as a black male in his 20s.
Well, Lieutenant, you don't have to do that. I have that information. One was 21 and one was 23.
Okay.
I have a question for the applicant. Thank you, Lieutenant Matson.
Thank you. Thank you.
I was flipping through your proposal here regarding the upgrading of the facility. As far as the seating and the changes that you would like to make, is that every theater? I guess there's 16 theaters within the complex. Would that be in every theater?
Go ahead.
Yes, it would be.
And just a better point, the IMAX that we brought in is the only, I mean, it was $1 million just for that IMAX. By the way, those 2 people that were arrested were a probation violation to happen on Mitchell outside of the mall area, according to the local newspaper. That's the information we have as a matter of public record for us. And when we looked into it, it was a probation stop, and maybe Lieutenant Matson can talk about that, but it wasn't, you know, somebody that was at our theater or necessarily at the movies as far as we could tell from the news articles. But that's, you know, when we heard that, we looked into that.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Lieutenant Matson, could I recall you, please? Can you explain a little bit? I understand that the theater is separate from the mall. However, that facility, Reading Cinema, is on the same footprint, and maybe community development can refer to this too. So they're on basically the same piece of property, and I believe they're a leasee of General Growth Properties. Is that correct? Can either the applicant address that, or?
Yes, it is.
Okay.
With 25-year lease.
Okay, thank you. So when the police department responds to crimes at, let's say, Valley Plaza and or the cinema, even though they're, like I said, they're separate, do you kind of consider them kind of one and the same as far as the transference of potential criminal activity can take place between those locations, let's say, you know, Target to the cinema or Target to some other area of Valley Plaza?
Yes, sir. That was what I was alluding to with regards to the criminal activity when we look at a totality of a footprint. I do just want to kind of bring a point of clarification as to the case that I was referencing. This was a case that took place on Monday, February 13th, around noon. Officers were dispatched to the Valley Plaza, where the person was reporting that they did see subjects walking around inside the mall in possession of firearms.
Now, you said persons observed. Who were those persons? Was that the security observed that? Or?
I believe it was security that was via closed-circuit television, if I believe.
Of Valley Plaza?
Yes, of the Valley Plaza. Yes. And so that was the specific incident that I was referring to as the most recent incident in around that footprint. And so what I was referring to when you assess crime is that oftentimes, like I said, people are drawn to a public place for specific reasons. The Valley Plaza offers many reasons to bring a group of people together, whether it be going to a restaurant, whether it be going to shop, whether it be going to the movie theater or anything else. Sometimes it's just to go hang out with friends and family or whatever. It's a common ground. And so when we look at the totality, do you attribute anything necessarily to one specific location? Generally, you'll have things such as if there is an armed robbery to a business, for example, or if there is a shoplifting or something. Oftentimes, those are going to be attributed directly to one particular location. But if you have anything in such a way as of going to and from your vehicle, oftentimes when you walk out, your vehicle's not there. Well, that's not necessarily going to be attributed back to the business itself. Nevertheless, there's a crime that has occurred on that footprint. And that was what attracts criminals, is that they know there is a lot of opportunity that exists at these places where you have a large group of people congregating for a variety of reasons. And so you look at it from a totality standpoint. A robbery, if you're walking out to your car and you're a victim of a robbery at gunpoint, well, you're not necessarily going to attribute that back to the one business where they were just in shopping or if they were in the restaurant having dinner or anything else. So it's the ancillary implications that can happen as you're loitering or you're walking or you're in transit to and from whatever it is this public place is looking at. So this is what we talk about when we look at a footprint, is this, it's very difficult oftentimes, especially with crimes such as robbery, auto theft, or anything else, to attribute it back to one specific location. So you have to look at the totality of crime, what kind of opportunity is brought to that footprint whenever you have this. And so when we look at things, for example, aggravated assaults, fights, oftentimes are attributed to alcohol. Can I necessarily say it's going to be related to one specific alcohol or not alcohol? You know, those would have to be a case-by-case analysis, but nevertheless, it's a consideration that you have to take and you look at. And so that's why there, again, we want to look at that totality. What will it bring to that footprint when we look at it? And that's a public safety standpoint that we have to look at, is what that entire environment will, you know, and the opportunities that exist. So that was the assessment that we, when working in consultation with staff, were trying to emphasize.
Thank you, Lieutenant.
Yes.
Does the applicant have anybody from GGP to speak in favor of this project?
No.
Okay. GGP is General Growth Properties. They own Valley Plaza Mall.
Well, they've signed off on the application, so I assume that...
That's not the question I asked, sir. Thank you. Ms. Kitchen, the again, you alluded to it before, that the applicant, if staff conditions are put forth and recommended on a motion, they could come back in 1 year, 18 months, 2 years, and ask for a CUP modification, correct?
That is correct, Councilmember Parlier, through the mayor. The process would be a request for a new conditional use permit to replace any existing one.
Okay. The applicant made a comment that, you know, this is coming to your city. And you're right, it is coming. But we need to manage it well. We need to ensure that our city is doing it right the first time out of the box. And because once we do it, it's going to be more difficult to go backwards and impose conditions that otherwise maybe should have been in place to begin with. The applicant made a reference to, and I believe it was the opening of the firehouse, is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. The firehouse venue, I also heard somebody outside of this forum talk about Chuck E. Cheese, how Chuck E. Cheese also sells alcoholic beverages. But the difference between, I guess, the firehouse and Chuck E. Cheese is neither of those facilities turn their lights off in close proximity to people sitting next to them. So my recommendation is, you know, it's really a balance between the needs of the business and the concerns of the community. So I'm going to go with staff recommendation. I know the applicant's not happy about it, but this is our first time doing this. We need to ensure that the public safety of the surrounding community is protected, and that ensure that their quiet enjoyment of their properties is also protected. So I'd like to make a motion in favor of staff recommendation.
Thank you. Councilmember Rivera.
Thank you, Mayor. Thank you, Mayor. So I have a few questions and a few thoughts. I guess my first question is, who sits on the BZA?
Representatives from different departments of city staff, including Public Works, the Building Department, and the Manager's Office.
Okay, so those are the three? Okay. Okay. I get that it's not binding, but two folks who I have extreme faith and confidence in felt that conditions at the time were okay, so I don't think the fact that it's non-binding now should preclude us from considering the actions they took there, but that's neither here nor there, I guess, at this point. You know, it's funny, for the first time I actually visited a theater like this down south, and I had a great time. I thought it was a great experience. I watched La La Land, which was a very long movie, but enjoyable nonetheless. And I went to a movie theater that's similar to what you see here, limited drinks to two per person. Now I'm a big guy, and it doesn't take two drinks to knock me down, so I had a perfectly fine time, and I can tell you how the movie went, and I'll tell you the ending as well. But I thought it was great. I loved it. I thought it was a great amenity for the community I was in, and thought, gosh, why doesn't Bakersfield have an amenity like this? Because I would certainly take advantage of it, and I'm sure other folks would as well. Yeah, I think it's always so unfortunate that we convince ourselves that folks aren't responsible enough to appreciate things like this, and in the process end up where we are this evening. I'm going to honor Councilmember Parlier's thoughts and wishes. This is in his district, but I do disagree. I don't think that three theaters out of 16 is a middle ground. I mean, eight would be the middle. So from a business perspective, I guess I just don't get why someone would invest, and hopefully they figure out a way to do it, why folks would invest so much money to have such a marginal impact on the business there. I hope we don't set a precedent for similar conditions on future projects. And I think the nature of a conditional use permit is that it is conditional. It's in the title. I think, you know, alternatively, unless I'm incorrect, as I understand a conditional use permit, because it is conditional, means it can be rescinded by the city at any time, correct?
That's correct, Councilmember Rivera. There would have to be findings made through a public hearing.
Okay. So, before we've even gotten out of the gate, before a project's even gotten off the ground, we've decided that the conditional use permit wasn't appropriate. And I guess I believe in allowing businesses and folks who have, you know, new creative ideas to give things a shot before I decide it's not going to work. So, I hope you guys can make this hybrid work at the facility. I'd be surprised if you do. But I do hope that as we enter 2018, we catch up with the rest of the state and start offering the residents and the citizens of Bakersfield greater amenities that make it just a little bit more fun to live here. Those are things I would appreciate having. Thank you.
Councilmember Weir.
Thanks, Mayor. I just have a couple questions to ask. So we've heard a lot of crime statistics here tonight, and I understand that, you know, there's crime in that area. Okay. If a restaurant was coming and it wanted to open in Valley Plaza, say it's a freestanding building, not inside the plaza, but it's a freestanding building. It's, you know, pick your favorite restaurant with liquor sales and a bar, and they wanted to come in to that area it's coming into the same crime statistics in the same area. Is that something that we would have a problem with in this particular area?
Councilmember Weir, I can speak to the land use component of that. Because this area is zoned C2, the code does allow for a restaurant that sells alcohol without a conditional use permit process. So a restaurant could go in here. And the reason for that is because the restaurant has the server that's present and a part of the alcohol transaction. BPD could speak to whether or not they may protest to addition of additional restaurants in the area.
Yeah, they do have a server, and I understand they bring that to you and everything, but they don't have a limit. I mean, they can drink until the bartender says, nope, you've had enough, or whatever the condition is. So do we expect that a movie theater, it doesn't have to be this one, any movie theater, if we allow a movie theater to serve alcohol, is that going to impact the crime in that area? I'm sorry, I just don't get the correlation between serving alcohol in the movie theater and crime that's already in that area.
Thank you, sir, for that question. The best we could do with regards to that would be to provide the crime statistics for that area. We often do, when it comes down to serving alcohol, sales of alcohol and stuff, is when we work with ABC, we look at a variety of issues. And one of the issues that we do is we look at the crime statistics within that specific area. And with that, our job is to report on the fact of that, what it is, and it becomes a discussion of many different perspectives as to whether or not that's going to be an acceptable or level or not. And so the best I could say with regards, can I make a prediction that there's going to be necessarily correlation with increased alcohol sales to increase crime? I can't make that assertion here, and that would not be proper for me to do so, sir.
Do we have a lot of those crime statistics that you quoted to us, do they involve alcohol?
I would have to do an independent research on each of those crimes, sir, to be able to provide an accurate answer to that. So I couldn't tell you that today.
Okay. Well, thank you very much.
Yes, sir.
That's it. Thank you.
Thank you. Vice Mayor.
Thank you, Mayor. I'm just a little concerned that I heard the applicant state that their intentions were substantially different from staff report's understanding of their intentions. I thought I heard the seats were going to be reduced 50% and upgraded, and staff's presentation stated seats as is, correct? And part of staff's presentation was based on the number of seats and how the other theaters or comparables had fewer seats, and so maybe their intentions are really more in line with what staff believes works. So I'm going to ask if perhaps we could continue this item, if Mr. Parlier would be willing to do that, and maybe we could actually have an application that showed what the intentions were and let staff decide whether or not that was something that they could support. Thank you.
Councilmember Sullivan.
Thank you, Mayor. Well, I have not heard, I had not heard of any theaters selling alcohol. So when I first did hear about it, my first, not only my first thought, but probably my first words were, oh no, what next? It caught me by surprise. I just hadn't heard about it. And then I probably said, oh, what is this world coming to? With some humor intended. But, and it was confusing, the way it was presented by staff, it was giving me the impression that it was going to be the regular seating and just the alcohol. And then, of course, you know, the two drinks, and there's all, you know, the two drinks and the wristband. Now, would that be when you buy the first drink? How is, or when you buy your ticket, how does the wristband?
The wristband, I'm sorry, I didn't hear you, but I'm thinking you're asking when we get the wristband. When do those, well, as a customer,
yeah,
get
sort
the wristband?
Of, that would be.
So, and just back me here, but generally what happens is when you go into the movie theater, we've agreed to have the alcoholic beverages to one concession, not out front, to the back auxiliary concession. You would walk through the concession stand, you would ask for an alcoholic beverage, you would be required to then show your ID, which the clerk or the person that's serving you would look at, assure that's an appropriate ID, slide it through the WeScan system, which checks it magnetically. That screen pops up. Then a wristband that's changed every day by color is added to your wrist. And as for the seating, that's kind of what we were talking about earlier, is we do these across the country in stages. So this is the first stage, is to get the entitlements, because again, without the entitlements, the investment can't come. I can represent to you that we are going to make the investments if we get the approval as we desire. I don't know how you could put that into a conditional use permit, but that's how the wristbands come about. Is that correct?
The only one addition I would say is, and it's an important one, so it is with before the ID is scanned in that interaction, our employees are also trained. They go through a training program to look for any possible intoxication already. So it's not just a matter of this is Councilmember Sullivan's face matching the ID, but does she seem to be in a state that she should be served a drink before I even ring the process? So that's a very important component, is all the, and it's not just the person selling the drink, it's all of our staff that gets that training.
On top of that, right now we have no training because we don't have alcohol, but as part of the conditions of approval, we would be mandated, as we do company-wide when we have alcohol, that every employee, from the person that's selling you the ticket at the front that may notice that your eyes are slurring, your speech is slurring, or your eyes are red, or shows signs of intoxication. So that additional training would go through. And to Councilmember Weir's point, they do have separate statistics about our address compared to the rest of the Valley Mall. It's within your packet. So over the course of the last 2 years, there's been 2 calls for service.
Thank you, Mr. Tandy.
Mayor Goh and members of council, thank you. I can answer the questions, I think, or one of the questions each from Council, Vice Mayor Smith and Council Member Sullivan. We have never seen this, and we're unaware of it. Council Member Rivera loaned us a copy, so we just went through it very, very quickly. But this is new.
I am in favor of is there a time urgency? Is putting this off until our next meeting, would that cause any kind of a hardship for you? Because there's definitely different information.
Well, obviously, we're seeking the approval from the BZA, and while there may be some information that wasn't provided, those are slides just like the slides that weren't provided. But our hope is to get the approval that we're looking for. So if that requires additional time, then certainly we would be amenable to that. We've been amenable the whole time. Paul Johnson's been great, and Ms. Kitchen's been great. So that would be amenable to us, and we can talk about it in further detail.
And on several things, we talked over the telephone.
Yes, ma'am.
And it was at that point before when I realized why you were calling and what you wanted to talk to me about, I was still at the, oh no, what next stage. But then reasonably, if someone was really wanting, the intent was to get intoxicated, that being the purpose for the day or the evening, they wouldn't go to a theater. I'm sure it's going to be fairly expensive, the beverages, and there are two, so that's something that's good. And I would think, oh, and are you intending to, with your intent, wanting all the theaters, which I'm not in favor of that at this point, but yet would you be wanting to change all of the seats and all of the theaters?
That would be our ultimate goal. That would be, the phase two of the project.
Oh, the phase two. So
right.
What would the phase one be?
This is phase one. I mean, we need to make sure, in every movie theater that we undergo the multi-million dollar renovation, we need to ensure that we have the entitlements in place. That being, the kitchen facility, where in some jurisdictions we need to get approval for that, the alcohol, those type of things. I mean, that's the building block for us to move forward. We can't go in to a multi-million dollar project without knowing that we've got all of our eggs in the basket, so to speak. So if we cannot get the approval, and if the approval is such that it's effectively a denial, then it's less likely that we will make that investment. But the plan is for Bakersfield, and again, I believe that Paul and I have talked about renovations to the theater coming after, and I'm not questioning that, and I would be happy to continue those discussions, but that would be our plan to renovate the entire theater to include the lobby. So it would be an overhaul of the theater. But again, I want to make it very clear, it would only be based on the approval for all of the theaters, theater rooms. Mm-hmm. Because again, those seats and those chairs and the screens are very expensive. The kitchen facility is very expensive. I would also just ask if any of the council members would wish to come to the theater and look inside of the theater while a movie is playing, so that you can see that the metal screens that we provide and the light that shines, while your eyes are focusing on that screen, it's very dark, but when you look back up, you see every single face, you see every single wristband, you are able to easily identify what's going on. And I would encourage, and I would invite you, let us know, come with the planning department, come with the police department, please come and look, because it's not like a dark room. I took my kids to the circus here in Bakersfield, and it was a very dark arena, and there was people drinking alcohol all around us. But that doesn't mean that you don't have the circus at Bakersfield. It's a large auditorium. I drove all the way here to see that, and it's akin to that. You have the Harlem Globetrotters that are coming. It's a family event. There's going to be people drinking alcohol there. There's the WWE, and so I would just encourage you, the unknown shouldn't be scary. Just please come and see the theater. Please come and see what we're doing inside.
Thank you, sir. Ms. Kitchen, we'll come right back to you, Councilmember Sullivan. I think she has something maybe that she can share to expand on this.
I would actually agree with the applicant on that last point. The unknown is not scary. However, what's been presented to staff tonight is new information. And this is it sounds like a new application. The proposal that was handed out to us does look to be more in line with what we've seen and what we found during our survey of other similar theaters. But again, this is different than what was presented to staff for the last 3 months as we've worked with them. So if the applicant is changing the proposal and this is what they'd like to present, we'd certainly like to work with them on that. On a new application for a conditional use permit, and we can bring that back to the BZA, or I believe, and Ms. Gennaro can correct me if I'm wrong, they could elevate that directly to your council.
Thank you, Ms. Kitchen. Ms. Councilmember Sullivan, go ahead.
Well, I was going to refer to the one of the last statements, not as scary as it sounds. So that's, I'm sure that's true. Mm-hmm. Being the first, and is it a benefit to the community? That, you know, is it really a benefit? And it perhaps is, you know. So I'm open. I get used to the different ideas when they come up. I'm curious now, the people in our audience, are you in fa- I mean, I someone made an appeal to the VZA. Are you people here, were you against this or in favor of this? And I don't mean this to be a personal question, but pardon me?
I'm in favor.
I see. Oh, well, right.
By a show of hands.
Yeah, in favor, I see. Interesting. Yeah.
Councilmember Sullivan, go
ahead. Yeah, that's helpful. All right, well, I think if we put this off, we'll have more information, and so I'm in favor of that. Thank you.
Councilmember Poilier, please.
Thank you, Mayor. I agree with staff. I know staff has worked really hard on this whole process, and the applicant has to be fair. But you know what I was initially told and presented, that this seems, again, totally different. Vice Mayor Smith and Councilmember Sullivan have both, you know, requested more time to take a look at this, and it sounds like you're not objectionable to it either for going back to the BZA on this new format, correct?
That's correct. And again, procedurally, because we're in an appeal situation, I believe this would be a new application for a conditional use permit.
Right. Councilmember Parlier, members of council, the issue that I have as an attorney procedurally is you're dealing with facts that are different from the facts that were presented to the BZA. So my recommendation to you is to move forward with the motion by Councilmember Parlier without prejudice. The applicant can then go back to staff, amend his application, and it can go right to BZA. And if BZA approves it, you never need to see it again unless there's an appeal.
Yes.
There's a recording of the BZA, and this was talked about, the seating, the renovations. I don't know where everyone else was, but I think one of the people are here. I mean, we talked about
Let me call Paul down, and maybe he can address some of this, too.
And
while he's coming down, I have a question for you.
Yes, sir.
Now, when you said this is phase one and phase two is a remodel or would be proposed remodel, what would the time frame for something like that be if...
That would be a question for the appropriate person, so I'll Terry.
Well, as Mike's already stated, you know, phase one, it depends on getting all the entitlements. So with the assumption that phase one happens and we get all of our permits and all of our inspections and everything, a remodel of this nature can happen in under a year once construction starts. It all depends on the way in which we do it. Sometimes you stage it where you keep some auditoriums open so that customers have a place to go and you're not denying families. Sometimes you shut down a facility for a couple of months. We haven't gone that far in the process to see how long it is, but generally it's under a year once you get all the permitting done and everything.
Okay, thank you. Paul? Could you just kind of help us understand the process and how we got here?
Honorable Mayor, Council Members, Paul Johnson, Planning Department. Council Member Parlier, are you asking for what I know about
just
the renovations?
Yeah, just kind of a recap of what was discussed. Let me refer to City Attorney. This really isn't even relevant. We just stand on the current motion and. We're just kind of going around in circles.
Well, Councilmember Parlier, Mayor, what I'm hearing is it's almost like, you know, what's coming first, the chicken or the egg? So the applicant has an obligation to submit what the applicant wants to do. The applicant submitted the application to your staff. The staff took it to BZA. BZA gave an opinion, and now it's on appeal. So the applicant is free to adjust, supplement, amend his application, but it's not fair to staff to give you a PowerPoint tonight and say, well, if I get the entitlements, then I'm going to go ahead and do the TIs. So again, I would encourage you to vote on the motion that you have tonight without prejudice to the applicant, and have the applicant then come back, amend his application to planning, and have planning go through the process again. I don't know how that hinders the applicant. And whether it hinders the applicant or not, you have an appeal before you right now, so there's really nothing to continue. Ultimately, you'll still have to render a decision on the appeal.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Paul. All right, then my initial motion stands, and if the applicant wants to come back with this new proposal and present it to the BZA and we kind of start all over again, then would you like to respond to something? Is that okay?
Well, I think the city attorney, I think if we can table this and make this an amendment, because again, if it can get elevated, we don't have to go through the fee process again. I mean, this will be our fourth hearing on this thing. And again, Paul didn't really get a chance to say much, but we did talk about these things at the BZA, and this was always our intent. I don't know where that got lost, but perhaps it was the phase one, phase two. But I would implore you, if you render this decision tonight negatively, as you are, it's going to have a ripple effect. And so I would just ask the city attorney that there could be some creative working between the two parties, where we could keep this open, we could amend the application as it lives now instead of killing it, and come back and do this one last time. Because the reality is none of the appellants are here. No one is here in opposition of the project. The question now really becomes, are we going to do the renovation, and how can you hold our feet to the fire? And so why make us go through that? Just because you know what's going to happen is that decision is going to get appealed, and we're going to come back a fifth or sixth time. So what I would ask the city attorney is, can we amend the application based on the comments and concerns that we've now received from the council, come back, provide that information to staff, and work on that together, and come back on the appeal. People show up, they'll be able to be heard, and we can go through this process again, but don't make us start over.
Okay, it sounds like staff is in council right now, so
okay.
I'll defer to them.
Mayor, would it be okay if we took like a 2-minute break?
Yes, let's do that. We'll come back at about 7:39, 7:40.
Maybe 7:40,
let's round it off.
Give him three.
Councilmember Parlier.
Thank you, Mayor. First of all, I'd like to withdraw my earlier motion. I'd like to make another motion to, and before the applicant freaks out, listen to the whole thing.
Okay.
Withhold the appeal, deny the CUP without prejudice. The applicant can reapply, come back directly to the City Council.
Correct. And just for clarification, Councilmember Parlier, the reason why staff is recommending that approach is, in upholding the appeal and denying the CUP without prejudice, that will enable the applicant to immediately go back, work with planning staff to put down what the applicant's intentions are in writing, and not have to wait the typical year that one would have to wait when an appeal is upheld. So they can do that expeditiously. Staff will work with them. And I think the city manager feels comfortable that there's no need to go to BZA. They can come immediately right to the city council.
Okay.
And it's a clean slate, and everyone then understands what needs to be done.
Would there be an extra charge to the applicant?
Council, city manager has indicated that they will waive that fee.
Okay. So that's my motion.
Vice Mayor?
Thank you, Mayor. Can I just have you repeat that?
Repeat it?
Please.
Okay. We're going to uphold the appeal to deny the CUP without prejudice, which allows the applicant to come back without waiting a year. Is that correct, City Attorney?
That is correct.
Okay. Then they can reapply, bypass the BZA, and come directly back with this item to the City Council.
And their fee will be waived.
Yes.
And the timing would be?
Anytime that they're ready to go.
Public notice would be how long?
We have to do the typical public notice, but that's not long. It's 10 days.
Okay. Okay, great. Thank you.
Councilmember Sullivan?
I think that's great. That sounds good. Thank you.
You have a motion? Please cast. Vice Mayor.
I'm sorry. I just want to add one more thought. I mean, what I'm looking for, as opposed to what the applicant said, is that, you know, phase one was get the entitlements, and then phase two is do the improvements. And I guess what I would be looking for is conditions of approval such that you are approved, assuming you do X. And if you want to phase it, then the phase are construction phases. And once you do X, then you are approved to do certain theaters, and then you improve other theaters. You know, I mean, that's my direction to staff, I guess, is what I'm saying, is those types of conditions of approval is what I'm looking for. Thank you.
Ms. Kitchen?
Thank you, Mayor. To follow up on that, Councilmember Smith, are you seeking a revised application in terms of the content that they provide us? The site plan that we have now shows the current layout of the theater with all seats, no removal, no reduction, no change. Would we like the new proposal to include a site plan that actually articulates what the changes would be?
Well, I think that my feeling is that I'm inclined to move forward and approve it, assuming that they are moving forward with the improvements that they said. And so I would like conditions to make sure they're moving forward with the improvements that they talked about.
You have a motion, please cast your vote. Oh, another one. Councilmember Parlier. A late clicker in.
We're not done yet. I agree with the Vice Mayor. Is there a way that, and I'm sure there is, just a site plan? I agree that we need to ensure that everybody is on the same, you know, page of music on this, and ensure that the applicant is doing what they say in this proposal. So would a site plan do that?
No. Councilmember Parlier, I think we understand Councilmember Vice Mayor Smith and your comments.
Awesome.
It'll involve several components of the application, but we'll take care of it.
Thank you, Mayor.
We have a motion. Please cast your votes.
Motion is unanimously approved.
Thank you. Madam Clerk, next item, please.
We have no reports, no deferred business, no new business, council and mayor statements.
Okay, we agree that we're going to be efficient in our time. So let's start with Councilmember Smith, Vice Mayor.
Thank you, Mayor. I just had one. We had on the agenda item 8N, which was improvements to the soccer facility, and we had bid that once before, and the bids were too high, and staff went back and split it out and rebid it, and we were able to do a lot more work, and just appreciate staff's work on that, and glad we can get that done. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Gonzalez.
Thank you, Mayor Goh. I just have three shout-outs I want to make tonight. One, to the Bakersfield Fire Department. There was a huge fire in my ward and on SB Street just a few nights ago. Structure loss, $400,000 to $500,000. It was a heavy fire, collapsing structure down to electrical lines, and there are many other hazards at the scene of the incident, and the fire department did an excellent job of putting that out without causing any further damage to other properties. So kudos to the fire department. Two, we had three community meetings for the residents of West Park regarding the Centennial Corridor, and I'd like to publicly thank Mr. Tandy in the city manager's office, as well as Caltrans, the TRIP department, as well as many other departments, the police department. There's many, many people who actually participated, Public Works, who joined us for these community meetings, and it was incredible. The feedback I got from the residents was very, very positive. They really appreciated the time that city staff spent meeting with them, talking about their issues one-on-one. And so it was a really great, really great exercise. So I want to thank all of those who are participants in that process and for giving up three evenings for that, to make that happen. And then finally, I had an opportunity to ride along with the police department's impact team today, and they do an excellent job really trying to address a lot of the quality of life issues around our city. I was really impressed. So kudos to all three.
Thank you. If there's nothing further, we stand adjourned. Oh, that's it. If we stand adjourned. Here we go.